Some people fish from the boat, while others fish from the shore. Summertime in Texas can be really hot, so why not try a little wading to keep your fishing cool? Get ready because it's time for the Texas Insider Fishing Report.
Welcome to the Texas Insider Fishing Report. Presented by Yamaha.
Hello, anglers, and welcome back to the Texas Insider Fishing Report. I'm Bree Gabrielle, and this is Captain Rick Murphy, and we've got an exciting show for you today in this last week of April, talking all about wading, right, Rick?
Absolutely. You know, wading in Texas is a thing that they do everywhere. And the one thing that's really cool about it is how they are able to spread out and really make a much bigger footprint than fishing from the boat. So I'm interested in hearing how the guys strategize when they're attacking a flat out there waiting.
Well, me too.
It's going to be cool.
You know, we always loved our theme shows, and I know our workbench guru does too. We missed you, Dave. Welcome back.
I'm happy to be back, and I like to wade. You know, it was some of the first fishing I did in salt water, so we're going to talk a little bit about that and how to catch some big redfish and trout while wading.
Sounds good. Well, I see you got all the gear.
I do.
All right. Well, where better to begin this Wade Fest than in the Garmin Middle Coast region with the Wade Master himself, Captain Bink Grimes. Talk to us, Bink.
I tell you what, our stiff southerly breezes, they pumped up our tides and pushed our trout tighter to the shorelines, and we're wading and casting to reefs and working sand and grass pockets. Wading is a great way to beat springtime winds along leeward shorelines. I waded a couple of days this last week and found fish over middle of shell in the East Bay. Now through the end of the summer is when I wade the most. We're going to work sand and grass on the incoming time with top waters and soft plastics. I wrote a book about wade fishing called Wade Fish Texas, published in Texas Fish and Game in 2004. It kind of spells out the how-tos and where-tos along the Texas coast. It gives GPS coordinates to some of my favorite spots and even plenty of walk-in spots in case you don't have a boat. So it's a pretty handy little gadget. Now, I want to give you some of the reports going on. And Palacios, guy Ray Sexton, said the trout bite is best on shrimp, and it's been excellent while wading. He's worked the south shoreline of West Matagorda Bay most days and concentrated wading the flats with the high tides. He said most of those trout have been hanging in about 40 to 50 yards off the shoreline. Fort O'Connor guy Lynn Smith, he's been doing great on protected shorelines for solid fish in the 18-inch class. Most of them come on live bait, but soft plastics is produced as well. He said the topwater bites picked up some. The water temperature has been about 73, 74, and so that's kind of highlighted our topwater action. Around Freeport, Bastrop, and Christmas Bay, there's fish all over the reef. Best have been around live shrimp on the edges of the reefs. And there's a lot of trout and black drum, redfish mixed in all on those reefs. In Matagorda, guy Michael Roth, he's been drifting live shrimp and catching limits. High tides have him tight to the shoreline. He's making long floats around slick and flipping mullet to 5 pounds. Then in Rockport, super flat and been good on small topwaters and corkies and Mariler soft deans. Photo there is the we've been jigging deep channels. Been the ticket on Mariler marsh minnows, and also a picture there of my cover of my book. If you want to check it out, you can find it online. We'll go to redfish. There's lots of shrimp in our bays. Our bait shrimpers are having no problem keeping tanks full at the bait camps. Normally, when that's the case, the fishing really turns on. The same pattern's been good around Palacios and Matagorda. Crab Lake, Oyster Lake, and Coon Island hold redfish on live shrimp and mullet. Tides are really high, and most of those fish are right on top of the shell. Waders have found those redfish tight to the grass with these bloated tides. Those small shrimp, they hide in that grass with the high tides, and those reds literally swim through the grass to nose those shrimp out. If you see a shrimp hopping in the grass, there's a good chance that redfish is right behind it. Chunky a little Berkeley Jaywalker right behind it. The best bet for reds has been along the beach, from Freeport to Matagorda to Port O'Connor as well. Slight sides reds have been good in the first gut. Full reds have been on the outside deeper channels of the second bar. kind of like around Matagorda Jetty and the Port Aransas Jetty. And then the surf side of Port O'Connor jetties, they're holding big old redfish as well. They're using blue crabs, cracked blue crabs, free line and Gulf shrimp, and their Carolina rigged table shrimp. Offshore, red snapper and mangrove were caught this week in state waters. It hasn't been that many days of tranquility on the pond, but man, as our temperatures warm up out there, all those pelagics are coming closer and closer to the beach. Still a lot of bull redfish and sharks around along the beachfront in Freeport. Same holds true in Port Aransas. So, you know, it's spring. Our tides are swelling. Things are coming closer to the beach. We're looking forward to another solid week of fishing along the Garmin Middle Coast region.
All right, thank you so much, Bink. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the mirror lure hotspots from the Middle Coast region. Bink says the trout are good in the back lakes with the higher tides. On live shrimp under Popping Corks and Berkeley Jaywalker top waters, the redfish are good along the shorelines of Port O'Connor on Bass Assassins under a cork, Bree.
All right, continuing up our coast, we're headed into the Fish Bites Upper Coast region with Captain Carl Weston, who has a lot of good tips and pointers when it comes to being one with the fishes. So, Carl, tell us how y'all do it up there.
Are you there, Carl? Well, let's see what Carl's report says here. So we'll get started. Yeah, I'll tell you. So he says, basically, hey, guys and gals, let's start off with one of the most intimate get-to-know-you fish style fishing styles, which is certainly wading here in the Upper Coast. This is an up-close and personal experience that many anglers enjoy. There's tons of areas that are easily accessible to anglers like to fish this kind of style of fishing. Also, there's a variety of wallet-friendly means of fishing.
That's
so
very
it's
true.
Pretty inexpensive.
There you go.
Exactly. All you need to do is get a sample of a spinner baits, bait casters, as well as a pair of waders, preferably one that don't leak.
Thanks for that.
And don't forget your PDF, your personal floating device, and a stringer so that you can carry your fish while you're after waiting. So, Carl, we're talking about using the Abu Garcia 6.5-foot rod with a Revo bait caster. You like that for your wading?
Yeah, I mean, this combo was lightweight, was real easy to carry, and it performed like a champ for us. I was very pleased with it. And moving forward, I guess you were touching on, you know, safety, the PFD we were talking about. That's such important. It's the most important advice you can give a fellow angler, I think, this wade fishing, is safety. Because you have to be so mindful of the swift current, rough bottoms. There are so many things that'll get you. You just really got to be careful to watch out. Not trying to be, you know, kill the spirit of fishing, but please be careful. We want to see you out there every day, not just one time. And, you know, get yourself some good boots and take a buddy and have a blast out there wade fishing, folks.
Tell us about this picture of Shane, Bub.
This was, Shane was red fishing. From his boat, they stopped and they waded. Just a great picture, a great fish.
All right, go ahead. Tell us about red fishing.
All right, they're back on the scoreboard again. It's been all redfish this spring. They're really hot. I know we sound like a broken record this spring, but if I don't mention the redfish bites, then I'd be skipping over some of the best fishing that we've had here in some time. Our cold weather seemed to put this fishery in high gear for some reason. You know, the bait fish are schooling around the shorelines and over the structure, and the reds are just on them heavy, Rick. These new hard plastics from Berkeley have been my favorite of late. We've got a chance to test some of these baits, like the Chopo 90 in bone color is my champ of the week. I couldn't beat it. And like a report the past few weeks have said, you know, the morning bite is great. The late afternoon bite is money. Over in East Galveston Bay, Trinity areas have been solid spots for great stringers of slot reds and trout. Bean Lake is getting a little warmer. Beachfront never disappoints. As long as you can find the schools of bait, you're on the fish. And, you know, moving from there offshore, got to touch on kingfish again. Let's talk a little bit about that. The kingfish bite is still on fire around the rock piles and oil platforms. The bait has been schooling over offshore structure, and the kings are sticking close to these areas. Putting live baits in a live well can drastically improve your chance of catching the bigger fish. Like a nice, slow, drifting troll
a drift, a troll, sorry, a hardtail rigged on a treble hook and a wire leader is our favorite method to catch the bigger fish. Now, if you're fishing over the rocks and your depth is around 100 feet, drop a chum bag over the side. It's a great idea. Rig yourself some cigar minnows, grease pull them out until you get a strike. And as you're drifting further, these kingfish will come closer and closer to the boat. But your first strike is going to be, that's your zone. That's where you're going to want to be. And I'm going to tell you about an hour of this bloody mess with these fish the way they've been biting. I hope you've got plenty of Starbright deck wash. Trust me, you're going to need it. And here's a picture of a wintertime king we caught a few weeks ago.
Nice, Carl. All right. Tell us what else is happening offshore.
Well, Dorado, we push a little further out. This is a fan favorite, too, in our area. Rick, there's some really big Dorado out in the deep water currents right now. These fish have been in the 150 to 200-foot depth. So that's about 70 miles off the coast of Galveston. There's not much grass formed up yet, but the color breaks are easy to see. We've been trolling a mix of R&R, mahi magnets, and some naked ballyhoo lately. Keeping it right about 8 knots, this seems to be the speed they like for these types of bait. Keep a lookout for anything floating in these current breaks. Smaller fish like to keep closer to the debris, or you know, the debris in the water, like you know. But make no mistake, the big fish are around. They school around these smaller fish all the time. And as always, when you're fishing for Dorado, keep a pitch rod handy. Many times we've brought a nice cow to the gaff and had a big bull right beside her. Don't miss that opportunity to throw a bait their way. And we've got a picture today with me and Tosh and a little Dorado.
All right. Well, thank you so much. Nice Dorado. Good job, Carl. Thank you so much. We're going to go ahead and take a look at the R&R tackle hotspots from the Upper Coast region. He says, inshore, redfish cast the hard baits along the oyster reefs. Try the Berkeley Jaywalker 100 in chrome or the Hijacker 100. And then offshore, kingfish, drift cigar minnows rigged on an Eagle Claw 4X treble on a wire leader over that bottom structure he was talking about.
Please. I've heard really good things about those mahi magnets from R&R Tackle.
Yeah, man, they work.
They work.
Built by a dude who knows.
Yes, exactly. All right, we've heard some great ways to get your weight on so far, and coming up, we're seeing how the Upper Fresh region does it. But first, I know Dave is itching to get back in the saddle and give us some workbench rigs and techniques, aren't you, Dave?
Yes, I am. But you know, we got all this stuff here. Even though wade fishing, you're supposed to go with not that much stuff. For some reason, I've got more stuff here than you'd ever need.
Yes.
But we all need it.
It looks
good. We're still
going
to have it.
Going to have a good bag with lots of pockets.
That's right.
We'll be back.
The Texas Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Yamaha. Reliability starts here. Fenwick. Bajio. Fresh eyes for a rich life. Garmin, plot your paradise. Fibertex, leaders in fiberglass fabrication and repair. Sportsman's Adventures, fishing for adventure. Penn, let the battle begin. And Skeeter Performance Fishing Boats, eat, sleep, fish.
Yamaha's reputation for saltwater reliability is driven by the 4.2-liter V6 Offshore's 97% reliability and overall performance. Reimagined with new advantages like built-in digital electric steering for incredible responsiveness and exhaust rerouting for more powerful reverse thrust, the legacy of the reliable Yamaha 4.2-liter V6 continues, now more refined and capable than ever. Yamaha, reliability starts here.
Pump up the performance in all of your engines. Into gear with StarTron.
For the Bay and beyond, team up with the best and rule the Bay in a Skeeter. Proven with 20 consecutive NMMA Consumer Satisfaction Awards. And now through June 21st, you can launch into your summer with sizzling rebates of up to $2,500. Versatility, control, performance, and design. The Skeeter Summer Sizzling Savings Event is happening now through June 21st. Visit your local dealer or online at SkeeterBoats.com. Skeeter, it's more than just a boat, it's a lifestyle.
Have you ever felt your heart pounding while feeling the power of a tarpon in the Florida Keys? Or experienced the changing colors of a mahi as you bring it on board? Whether it's in the Bahamas, the Florida Keys, Guatemala, or the Florida Everglades, Murphy's Law Sports Fishing has the ability to guide you to the fish of a lifetime. To book your trip today, call 305-246-0673 or go to murphyslawsportfishing.com.
So the rigs and techniques here at the bench, you know, Dave, every week we talk about some kind of technique, and you got lots of stuff to talk about.
Yes, I do. You know, we're going to talk about wade fishing. It was some of the first fishing I ever did in salt water, you know, because it took me a little while to get some scratch up for a boat. So I did a lot of walking, and I walked many a mile, you know, casting and walking and casting and walking, trying to catch trout and redfish on some, you know, really nice flats. You'd find a nice hard bottom flat with some good grass on it, some potholes. You know, a little bit of bait working on it. It's a good place to just jump out of the truck and wade right in and go try to catch them. Now, you know, making a long cast is very important. A lot of times we'd go fishing at night and get us a bunch of crabs. We'd go red fishing, you know, we call them channel bass. And, you know, instead of wading 100 yards out into the bay at night, you know, with all the stingrays and bull sharks and whatnot, you know, we'd, you know, bring out a big ladder and stand on the ladder and make long casts out and try to catch some of those big reds that are cruising the flats at night on a big crab or a live croaker or something like that. And at the time, I'd really
Is it safe to say that anytime you're foot fishing, casting, the farther you can cast, the more you ground you're covering?
Right, right. And if you're in a place where you don't want to walk all that way, you know, you can also make a long cast to keep you from walking, you know. So I'd love to have had one of these Alvies back then, you know, one of these side casters, because I can easily cast with this 20-pound braid, which is hard to break. You know, 20-pound braid's hard to break. I can cast that 100 yards easy with a 1-ounce weight and a 2 or 3-ounce croaker on it. Like, you get a little rig like this here, a fish finder rig, you know, with a nice circle C hook on it. I think that's a 5-aught.
Right.
And, you know, you can put you a nice croaker on there, a big chunk of mullet head, about any kind of bait, even a live bait, and toss that out 100 yards and stake up. You know, if you can either hold it. The good thing about the Alvie is they have that little short handle.
Right.
So you can hold on to them. You know, you don't have this long handle between you and the rod. You can stand there and hold it, and these stealths are really, really light. They're made out of carbon fiber, so you don't even feel
them. Yeah, the rod, those big, long rods.
Yeah, this
one
here, too. Yeah, this is one of the new stealth rods, and it's 13 feet long, and it weighs nothing. You know, and when you put that carbon fiber reel on it, you can stand there and hold that all day. And that's, you know, that's what those Australian guys do. They wade in the surf back and forth. They walk with these things.
Right.
And that's why they don't have those long handles on them. And yet, you know, you can really get a good depth.
And so this is in case you don't want to sit there and hold it. Right.
Right, Dave? Yeah, you can get out there a good ways, put one of those, you know, tall, that's a 50-inch spike. You can, you know, get you a 3-pound hammer and hammer that thing into the ground and stick the butt end
of the Alvie in
there. Exactly. And then that thing's way up high, too. So you can get a long stretch on that.
So what are some of the other things that you got here? You got lures?
Yeah, well, you know, if you're not into, you know, making those long casts with the Alvies, if you're a more traditional guy and want to use a bait cast or a spinning reel, I always suggest to get you a nice pair of boots.
Right. I
always used to use a pair of Converse tennis shoes because that's what I had. You can buy
Converse,
really cheap.
Baby.
Yeah, you can buy really cheap waders. You know, I wouldn't use a nice pair like that. I'd wear a pair out first,
yeah,
and then I'd use
them. I know
them.
Your style.
And that, you know, make sure they're really, I like Converse because they have a lot of laces on them and you can lace them on real tight and you wouldn't leave your shoe. And if you're fishing in a place where it might be muddy, you know, you want to have a boot or a shoe that's going to stay on because you don't want to leave one halfway across the flat.
What are some of your favorite lures to cover this ground?
Well, I like topwater lures, you know, any kind of topwater lure. These little Berkeley ones there are really nice. Anything that you can keep moving, because like you said, you're wanting to cover ground, and if you're working those things across the top of the water all the time, you're going to get bites and bites and bites.
So Gold Spoon, another good one to have in your box?
Yes, oh yeah, Gold Spoon is a really good lure to have. You know, put you a swivel on the front of it, you know, get you a little split ring and a little tiny diamond ball bearing swivel. They make little tiny ones that are 50 pound test, and it gives that spoon a great action and will never spin up your spinning reel or your bait casting line, because that's the big deal with spoons is, you know, they like to spin and get your stuff all spinned up. I also like to use soft plastic baits, you know, saltwater assassins and stuff like that, and any kind of soft bait, anything that looks like a redfish, I mean a little bait fish, so.
All right, so what do you think, Bree?
Well, I think if you're in the surf, Alvey Reels is where it's at. You got to get yourself one. All right, it's time to get up close and personal with the resident fish in the Upper Fresh region. So, Johnny Geis, tell us how and where it's done. Let's go catch those fish.
Okay, hello, Rick and Bree. Hey, since we're talking about this wade fishing this week, I reached out to Captain Kerry Thorne. He is the go-to expert for wade fishing around those creeks around Lake Louisville and the Bond. Kerry offers some guided trips wading and fishing in the many creeks that feed these two reservoirs, and he knows the access to get in and out. On white bass, Kerry's reporting that the sandies are still thick in the creek systems. They move up the creeks to spawn this time of year, and they're still there. With all these cold fronts we've been having, it's been knocking the spawn back further into the mud. So Kerry predicts that you can still pull the limits out of the creeks until about the second week of May. Most creeks will hold up to then. The lack of rain has a lot of the females, the bigger fish, not pushing all the way up the creek system. They've been mainly found at the bottom of the creek, closer to the lake, up to about halfway up the creek. The males, they have pushed all the way up the creek, and they're going to be there until the spawn is over. The hybrid stripers, Kerry says, made their push on the last rain, so him and his customers are limiting out on the hybrids every morning. Predominantly, Kerry's using 4-pound monofilament. It's a big key in catching these hard-fighting white bass. He says if you use your 6-pound line, you just cut your catch ratio in half. It's kind of hard to believe, but that's what's working for him. Kerry only uses a 6 to 8-pound mono when he's throwing jerk baits or inline spinners. Kerry says his best lure right now is a 16th-ounce pink head jig with a tiny fluke-like plastic in albino color. Very specific rigging. Hybrids are biting on the crawfish, live gizzard shad, and swim baits and jerk baits. You have a very tight window on the hybrids every morning because they shut down once that sun gets above the trees, so you got to be there early. Best fishing time right now is safe light until approximately 9:30 in the morning. If it's a bright, sunny day, fish the shady, deeper pockets. Be sure to wear some good polarized sunglasses, and you can see those fish clouds holding in the deeper pools. Next thing he's catching is crappie. The wading, he says, this spring for crappie has been fairly good. When the floodgates to the two lakes are open, the catch ratios went down a little bit, but when the gates closed back, Kerry and his customers are limiting out on a daily basis to 25 crappie a person. The white and chartreuse or black chartreuse, the color really doesn't seem to matter as long as it's on that 16th ounce jig head in pink. While wade fishing, they'll place the jig next to all four sides of button willow, just a little brush in the water, lift that jig approximately 3 to 5 inches off the bottom, hold it real still, no bites, and slowly move on to the next button willow. Each bush might hold one fish, but if you catch a female, that means there should be a male at the same button willow, so try to catch one more fish before you move on to the next one. He says if you catch one male on a button willow, somebody's already got that female, so move on. The shallow water crappie bite should last a few more weeks. And here's a picture that Kerry shares, a recent wade fishing trip, and customers, just like in saltwater, they're using a stringer to hold their catch there. Young lady's got a lot of fish on that stringer.
Wow.
Nice.
Check out Captain Kerry Thorne's guide service if you want a great wade fishing trip anywhere around the North Dallas area. All right, let's move on to the bass here on Lake Fort. What a week this has been. As you know, the Bassmaster lead anglers got here, and man, did they experience some big fish action. Bass, man, they were caught on a variety of techniques, but the jerk baits like the Berkeley Cutter 90 and 110 caught some of the big ones. More and more of the anglers were becoming experts in using their forward-looking sonar, their Garmins, and locate these and target suspended bass. So when you locate a big fish out about 20-25 foot in the front of the boat, present your bait right on his nose, you're going to catch some big fish. And so a lot of the 4 to 6 pound bass this week were caught on the beds, but the windy weather and cloudy, and we had some heavy rains during the tournament, it didn't hold up for the pattern all week like everybody expected. So there's still some spawning bass on the beds. We got the full moon right now, and we expect another wave. So you can find these spawners on your forward-looking sonar, too. I know a couple of guys are having good luck of seeing the fish out in front of them, even on the real dingy water. So this tournament produced some heavy limits and numerous lures and techniques, and they produced abundance of 4 to 9 pound bass. It's really hard for a local angler that's his home lake to win a big tournament like this, but our own Lake Fork guy, Lee Lizzie, he won the 4-day event with 20 bass, get this, Rick, 112 and a half pounds.
Wow.
Final day weight was over 42 pounds, and is the third largest weight ever caught in a BASS event. And he caught all of these fish on camera on a topwater bait.
Wow.
So with the big bass, caught on the final day, weighed 9 pounds, 2 ounces. And man, we're so proud of the young man. It's amazing that the fish he caught in the community hole, and he was there when the shad spawn happened and the big fish moved up. So once again, Lake Fork proves it's still the premier big bass destination. So I'd like to invite all our viewers to come on out to Lake Fork and catch some of these big ones. Bites on.
All right, thank you so much, Johnny. We're gonna go and take a look at the hot spots from the Upper Fresh region. Johnny says, Louisville, the white bass and crappies are spawning up the creek. Use 4 pound line with a white 16th ounce jig head minnow. And then Lake Fork, the bass are on the beds. The Berkeley topwater, jerk baits and soft plastics are working best.
All right, and here's your weekly reminder. If you want to win this very restored 1952 Chevy 3100 Hot Rod, all you have to do is purchase raffle tickets at ccaflorida.org/hotrod. And of course, you have to win. All right, up next, we are checking in with the Lower Fresh and Startron Middle Fresh regions. So stay with us, and we'll be right back here on the Texas Insider Fishing Report.
All right.
The Texas Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Contender Boats, always in the game. Bass Assassin and Saltwater Assassin, the best lures, period. Alvey Reels, a better way to fish. Berkeley, your fish, our science. Murphy's Law Sport Fishing, book your trip today at murphyslawsportfishing.com. And Penn, let the battle begin.
The Yamaha V-Max V6 SHO continues to deliver the level of performance that pro bass and multi-species anglers demand. Underneath a bold and aggressive new look, an upgraded charging system with 40% more charging power meets the amped-up demand for today's advanced electronics. The V-Max SHO, raw power, reliability, and exhilarating performance for every angler who loves the sport enough to invest in the best. Yamaha, reliability starts here.
Finding a shoreline is easy. Finding a sure thing is not. For over 20 years, anglers from Kitty Hawk to California and every shore in between have come to know one thing. That nothing says no to fish bites. So just stop with the fishing and get busy with the catching. Ask for Fish Bites or Fish Bites Fight Club Lures or visit fishbites.com.
Today's Power Pole tip is about the Sea Monster Network. As most of you know, PowerPole has always been a technology-driven company and will continue to innovate new products and technologies now and into the future. It was about 6 or 7 years ago that we looked at all the different technologies that were available on the market, but they all had limitations like Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. So we designed and built the Seamonster network from the ground up, specifically designed it for the marine industry so that anglers could wirelessly control everything on their boat from bow to stern. Now, it may not be as obvious as the powerful anchors on the back of everyone's boat, but it will soon be just as widespread. So, next time you're in the store and you're picking out your favorite marine accessory, look for the Seamonster logo on those products. And that is your PowerPole tip.
Well, wading in the lower fresh region can be done in a variety of lakes. And this week we're talking about Lake Falcon, Choke Canyon, Decker, Bastrop, LBJ. So Matt, if you're ready, so are we.
All right, let's get this thing going. You know, we're concentrating on wading this week, and there's lots of lakes where you can wade. You need to find public access. You know, the state parks and the marinas are great areas to find, you know, get the ability to get to the water. You want to concentrate on shallow areas that have rock or standing timber to find the most fish. Keep it simple when you're wading. Throw a small spinnerbait or a Texas rig, soft plastic, and that'll catch you some bass that are in those areas. Also, you might want to throw a small crankbait, a little bitty one, and that'll catch you a smorgasbord. I mean, you'll catch white bass, largemouth bass, perch, crappie, whatever. But get to the water and get out there and have a good time. We're going to start talking about some largemouth bass now. Start out with a report from Mike Bates at Choke Canyon. The shad spawn is coming to an end, but there's still a good early, you know, an early bite shallow. It only lasts about 30 minutes, though. Get your spinnerbait or chatterbait. Seems to be best because the hydrilla is growing fast and those lures work well over it. Cast it up to the bank and roll it over the top. The rest of the day, you want to concentrate on the outside edge of the hydrilla with a Texas rig and catching really good numbers there right now, lots of big ones too. Also an offshore bite with a deep crank and a Carolina rig heating up. Brian Cotter sent me a report from the Austin area, like Decker's fishing really well, catching lots of fish in the discharge on a small straight tail swim bait. Rig it on a belly weighted hook and just let it fall through them. The current will give it its own action and he's catching a lot of fish that way. Lake Bastrop, you also got some schooling action on Lake Bastrop. Throw small topwaters at these fish. You want to have a long rod and a reel that you can throw a long way. Another way to catch them is also on a little spoon. They're schooling on little bitty bait, so you want to use a little spoon. You might catch some bigger ones with a crankbait under the schooling bass, or also throw some soft plastics on the bottom. Like LBJ is fishing well with catching some big ones. Throw you a frog in the back of the pockets and you'll get some really big blow-ups, and that's so fun to watch them hit a top water. If you don't catch them there, you want to concentrate on the docks. Skip a jig as far under the dock as you can, and that, you know, that's actually if you're targeting big ones. If you want to just get the most bites you can, get a wacky rig, soft plastic, and work it around the docks, and that's the way to get the most bites. Got a picture of one of Brian Cotter's young customers with a little bass from one of the central, you know, lakes in that Austin area. I've got to love the kids when they're smiling like that.
Yeah, you do. All right, tell us about the catfish, Bub.
All right, Falcon Lake catfish, water temps have hit the 80s. Catfish are really shallow. You know, most of them are up there spawning, and, you know, they spawn later than the bass do. Concentrate on the high spots along the river. As well as the backwaters, smaller shad have been the best bait because of the shad spawn. You're getting more bites that way. That's got a picture there, Ram Reyes with a group of his customers, a bunch of youngsters in there with a big stringer of old blue cat.
All right, how about some crappie, Bub?
All right, we got some crappie going also. The crappie are through spawning back out in the deep water in the brush piles down at Falcon. You want to look for those piles in that 12 to 20 foot range, get you an 8 ounce jig,
lower it into the brush pile, and limits are really common right now. Monkey milk color, jumbo chartreuse, or red and chartreuse are the best colors for the plastic tails that you put on that jig.
All right, Matt, thank you so much. Great report. It's time for the Fiber Tech hotspots from the Lower Fresh region. Matt says that Falcon Lake crappie are cooperating these days. Find a brush pile in maybe 12 to 20 feet of water and get it after it. And then you might want to try an 1/8 ounce jig, and a small plastic tail are producing easy limits as well. So don't forget that.
Don't forget it. All right, the StarTron Middle Fresh region has Toledo Bend and Sam Rayburn center stage. So let's listen to Matt Loescher and see what we need to do to catch some fish this weekend. Hey, Matt.
Hey, Bree. Yeah, real quick on the wading topic. You know, there's just not a lot of wading going on in the Middle Fresh region this spring, mainly because we've seen a lower than average lake level on most of the reservoirs. But that's what you want to look for, is that higher water when you want to get out there wading. So keep that in mind. But I'm going to roll in now to the bass report, starting out with OH Ivy. Mr. Jared Poole and the Hill Country Hammer crew down there are still catching some good bass on that lake. He says that they're starting to eat topwater bait. So that's got to be a lot of fun with those big bass on that lake right now, eating those topwater baits. And then he said a small swim bait is good as well. He mentioned that there are still a few on beds, and got a photo here for you of a couple that they plucked off those beds. A couple of twin 8-pounders there. One with a huge girth, real beautiful fish.
Man, nice. All right, what else you got for us, Bub?
Jared also got me a report this week from Lake LBJ. He said that the bass there are done spawning, and they're hanging out under the docks now. He said the best way to catch those is on wacky rigs and on walking bait. And now I'm going to move up to Sam Rayburn. Up here, the water level has jumped way up. It's still above full stage, and so there's plenty of shallow cover to be throwing at. I love a frog and a swing jig in the white colors right now. That's my go-to bait for that deal because the shad are spawning. So you want to look for those bait fish, especially real early in the morning. You'll find the bass with them. Then out on the point, around that hydrilla, that bait is still productive, or that bite is still productive as well. That Carolina rig is still good. It's really hard to beat through that hydrilla, just dragging it around down there with a Bass Assassin vapor shad. It imitates those shad really well that are hanging out spawning right now, and that's been a really consistent bite lately. Then over on Toledo Bend, we've had another round of bass show up in the spawning pockets a little later than normal this year. It's kind of been a strange spawn. And then there's also a shad spawn in full swing right now. So kind of a lot going on here. We've had heavy rains as well in this part of the world this past week, so the lake has jumped up and muddied up a lot of those areas that had been productive. But if you'll get out in the areas that have less flow, like some of the small pockets off the main lake that don't have a creek in them, you'll find better clarity and some active fish in those. My go-to baits right now are a Texas rigged crawl worm or a Bass Assassin Boss Shiner swim bait in bluegill or shad colors. That's been catching some big fish for me lately. Now, moving over, switching out to the crappie. That bite kind of leveled out some on Toledo Bend this week. We've been hammered by some of that crazy spring weather lately. It's made things a little more challenging for us. However, we're still catching them pretty well most days, when we can get out and fish where we want to without so much wind. But we're catching them primarily in deep water now. Most of them are done spawning. Some of the fish are still hanging on the bottom as they move out on the points and such, out to that deeper timber. And then others are suspended up in the trees that have already made their way out and set up in that deep timber. The Panfish Assassin Pro Tiny Shad is a killer for that bite on a 16th or a 32nd ounce lead head jig. The color's still the same. I like the monkey milk on a bright day, or an electric chicken if it's cloudy or real windy out. And I got a photo here for you of some real nice crappie I caught with the Dorman family this past week. Got some nice slabs there. We had a good time that day. The weather cooperated for us. And then over at Sam Rayburn, the crappie bite is real similar to what's going on at Toledo Bend. A good portion of the fish have made it out to that deeper timber in about 15 to 30 foot of water. But over there, they've got that hydrilla grass. So some will always stay up around that in about 6 to 12 foot. But in either instance, that those same two jigs I mentioned before are certified catchers, so give them a try in that grass or out in the brush as well.
All right, Bub, thank you. Great report from the StarTron Middle Fresh region. It's time to take a look at the hot spots from the Middle Fresh region. Our guide there, Matt, says the bass are in the spawn and post-spawn stage in the Middle Fresh region. So try swim baits and topwater baits are hot. Crappie are biting jigs really well in 15 to 30 feet of water. What do you think about that, Bree?
OHIV is just every week. Those bass are incredible.
I know.
Twins, just like no big deal.
I think we need to go.
I think we do too.
Next year, we'll just move the whole report the week back or a couple weeks, maybe a couple months.
There we go.
Yeah, and we'll just go bass fishing in Texas.
Sounds good.
All right.
I'm there. All right, maybe. Coming right up on the Texas Insider Fishing Report. The Albee Lower Coast region is gracing us with its presence, and so is Dave Farrell at the workbench for new products. Dave, what you got?
Hello.
Scissors?
These aren't your mama's scissors, I'll tell you that. I think these things will cut a blue crab slap in half.
Oh, those are definitely my mama's scissors then. We'll be back.
What's mama have to do with scissors?
I don't know.
The Texas Insider Fishing Report is brought to you by Ameritrail, load, launch, relax. Fenwick, turn on the bite anytime, tie on a MiraLure. Diamond Fishing Products, our reputation is on the line. R&R Tackle, from our tackle box to yours. Berkeley, your fish, our science. And StarTron, cures and prevents ethanol fuel problems.
An entirely new species of extreme predator is moving offshore. The Yamaha 5.6 liter V8 XTO offshore outboard. Extreme big block thrust and power in the industry's first direct injection four stroke. Quiet, efficient, powerful, and proven Yamaha reliability. More than an outboard, it's a fully integrated power system. The all new Yamaha V8 XTO offshore.
Only reel with over 100 years of heritage. Albee Sidecast reels allow you to cast over 150 yards with up to 900 yards of capacity. Albee's state-of-the-art drag and 22-inch retrieve rate per wind is perfect for any surf challenge. Albee reels are manufactured to best practice standards and are in fact so robust that the Albee also comes with a 10-year salt and sand warranty. For more information, go to alveeus.com.
So guys, every once in a while you recognize that your boat is in some bad shape. So you're gonna wanna take some time to really clean up the boat. I'm gonna give you a couple easy tricks like we're gonna be using on this Contender to make it worth your while. So the three steps that we're gonna use today for this Starbite cleaning and the giving this boat a new facelift is simple. First thing we're gonna do is get all the stains off of the boat. We're gonna use the hull cleaner on the hull, spray in the hull. I'm using a magic sponge to make sure that I get it on evenly. Then after that, we're gonna use a deck cleaner to get all the black streaks off of the deck. Now, once we've cleaned everything and we've got all the stains off, the second step is we're gonna simply wash the boat with a boat wash to get all the chemicals that we use to get the stains off out of the boat, rinsing it real well. Then we'll bring it in, put it in the garage so that it's in a cool environment, dry it off, and then we're gonna come along with the Premium Restore Wax
Now we've chosen the medium to heavy oxidation because this boat's been living in the sun. We want to get all that oxidation off of the console and along the top of the deck where it's been really exposed, and that'll clean it up quite nicely. Then we're going to come back with a premium wax that Starbright makes, and that's going to seal it so that it lasts a long, long time. Don't try to substitute it with anything else because Starbright has spent hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars to make sure that you have the right formula for the right application. If you got any questions, you can certainly go to starbright.com and check out all the different products that they have.
Speaking of cool products, we're here at the workbench and we're going to actually talk about some of these products tonight.
You made that boat look new. It was very nice.
A lot of elbow grease.
Yeah, I bet. Well, first off, we're going to start there with the Taco adjustable gunwale mount fillet table. You know, this is an awesome piece of equipment here. If you're catching fish and wanting to clean them, you can just take this table out from underneath the center console, or you can even carry this on a little skiff up in the front because it folds right, this whole thing folds right up. It goes right in your gunwale, tightens up. It can go on from a near vertical all the way to a 30 degree angle, 15 degree and 30 degree. So you can, always have a level table. It's got a really robust system there, stainless or an aluminum that's not going to come apart. All your stainless steel bolts on it. It's got really nice designed wells on the top there, so everything drains off board, overboard.
Drains overboard.
Yep, through the holes there.
Put your knife in the knife holder here.
Exactly, and pliers on the other side if you want to. Just a really cool tool, It's got a nice, that handle's really rugged, and it's got that made out of FDA approved high density polyethylene. It's not gonna rot, and it's UV resistant as well.
So I like how storable it is.
Yeah, exactly.
A lot of times we don't carry that because it's such a pain in the butt to put it away. But this,
and then my wife
nice
gets angry when I clean them in my sink. TacoMarine.com.
Thanks for sharing that.
she does get mad. Anyway, next we got some G juice there from TH Marine. It used to be called U2 Pro Formula, but this is a saltwater version as well. It's a bait well treatment. If you have a bunch of bait, you want to keep it alive and frisky, this is the stuff you use. It's at 1/2 ounce, will treat 30 gallons of bait well, and it's easy to measure right here. You just squeeze the bottle and it'll give you a 1/2 ounce up to 1 ounce. It's non-toxic, removes nitrates and ammonia chlorine and all kinds of stuff. And heavy metals.
Fish put off.
It'll stop bleeding. It adds electrolytes and it replaces their slime after a while if they live in there. And it aids in maintaining the pH of the product, of the bait well. So, it's great. If you want your bait to stay alive, give them some G-Juice.
G-Juice.
At thmarine.com, you can get some of that.
Okay, G.
Staying with the juice.
This is
juice for your gas tank. Starbright Startron Diesel for your diesel gas tank. That's an enzyme diesel treatment. It stabilizes fuel for up to 2 years. It'll rejuvenate fuel if you got some old stale fuel laying around. Put some of that in there and it'll perk it right up. That bottle right there treats 512 gallons. So it's a highly concentrated, 8 ounce bottle treats 250 gallons. It's good for any of your, storing any of your diesel product. If you have an RV that has a diesel generator in it, or if the RV runs on diesel gas, it reduces emissions, it eliminates carbon buildup on all the stuff.
Or you have a house in the Bahamas where you only go there 6 months out of the year and you want to treat your fuel because you're not turning it over quite as fast because you have a solar system and so you're not using as much diesel, this is perfect for it.
That would be perfect for that.
I'm just sharing
I understand.
A personal experience of my own of how I use the Startron diesel treatment stuff.
I got it. Go to starbright.com and get some of that. Anyway, these are the Bubba Blades medium shears. It's called the Bubba medium shears. They have micro serrated blades, and like I said before, I think that thing could slice through a blue crab, no problem. But at the same time, it'll cut mono and braid. They're very sharp, but they can cut very small things. So that's a really cool thing.
Look at how thick
that cardboard is. That went right
through
it.
Put your finger out.
No, I'm not going to do it.
Come on.
It's got a little hook sharpener on the edge here. It's also got a little spike in there that you can clean the eye of a jig out. It's got a crimping tool inside here. It's got a bottle opener on the end. I mean, you know, that looks just like a pair of scissors, but it's got all kinds of stuff on there. Nice, you know, really good rubber grips on there. That's the tip, you know, iconic Bubba blade look. And like I said, right here on this side is where there's a little hook sharpener and everything. So,
hey man, tell these Bubba guys if they want to show off their knives, I just got to send them because I like their products.
They have good stuff. They really do.
Where do we go if we want to buy any Bubba?
BubbaBlade.com.
Okay.
They get all of
them. There you go, Bubbas.
Who knew a pair of scissors could do all of that?
I know. It's amazing, isn't it?
Amazing. All right, let's see what we're catching from the shallows and the deep in the Alvey Reels Lower Coast region with Captain Chad Kinney. Looks like a promising weekend ahead, Chad.
Tell you what, things are heating up and, also, what I love talking about, we're going to talk about some wade fishing here for the inshore and in the offshore. Of course, we'll get to that. But the wade fishing, it's the best down here in the lower Laguna Madre, in my opinion. That's what we're known for. We got miles and miles of flats from cap deep to knee-deep water. They're crystal clear. So if you want some wade fishing, definitely come on down here. Corpus South, we got some great stuff. What helps you here is you got to really utilize your tools. You know, you can wade off the bank if you want to and try to get way out there, but if you get the shallow sport boat, you can't beat that. I've been running them since 1984. I started out with an 18, ran all their models all the way up to the X3 model right now, which will be my fourth one. And these things will get you up really shallow where the fish are at right now. And what you can do is utilize that with the power pole and get to the fish, power pole down, and you start your wade. So basically what you need to do is look to the flats on the east side, basically from Port Mansfield, Roy City, down to South Padre, east side up there. Those fish are starting out in about a foot of water, real early in the morning, foot to 18 inches, except maybe mid-calf deep of water. You'll see some mullet movement, and when you see that, best thing to do is also, you know, kind of do some S-turns looking for them, shut down and power pole down. You don't want to run straight through and power pole and go wade back to your mud trail, you know, so go down with the wind. So power pole down, spread your anglers out evenly. This is kind of a pet peeve, but it's real simplistic stuff. Keep them even and stay even, not to spook the fish in front of you, so make sure you guys are kind of going evenly together. Also look for your wakes for your redfish or any bait movement. Cast at 10, 12, and 2. That covers a lot more water as far as your baits in the water. Once you get into the fish, slow down a bit. You know, stop walking. Don't have a power walker through there. They're going to probably be feeding in a certain area and kind of slow down a bit. Another reason to wade fish, you're definitely a lot more stealth in it. You have tower front. If you're drifting, you know, on a boat, what's going to happen is you're going to catch one, maybe two fish. You can drift right through them. You're going to stop and you have to jump up and shoot out, blow them all and spook them out. So wading is definitely the way to go, in my opinion. And just keep on walking and definitely utilize your power poles also and keep your remote with you, hanging around your neck. I get about 50 yards, 80 yards from it, power pole up, drift right to me, keep on going, and you keep on doing that for as long as you feel like it. So I got a picture up here instead of fishing. Here's how you should wade fish. We got one guy that's a little farther out, but not far, and the other guy's catching a redfish right there.
Nice. All right. Tell us about the red fishing, Bub.
Tell you, red fishing, so we're talking about this with wade fishing, but red fishing's what's going on down here right now. It's been real steady up shallow on the east side, like I mentioned, for the wade fishing. Real early, you know, drop them off. They're going to be up there, and they're going to drop off as the day continues. So there's going to be a lot of undersized fishing there, which is still a lot of fun. You catch them, then there's going to be some slot reds mixed in with them. You need to cover a lot of ground by making some long wades. And if you're going to use some tackle there, you can use an Alvey spinning reel. A 60 works perfect up there in that shallower water. You can land any redfish you want to in that 60. If you want to get a little bit bigger, you can go to an 80. And then and you got plenty of dragon at 60 also, and holds plenty of diamond braid on that. Like I said, you can land anything you want. So we're throwing Mirror Lure Top Dog Juniors early. Also try the Berkeley Jaywalker 100. Has been working really good. Grass is pretty clean up there, so you're in good shape to go. And when those mullet start dropping off and start going out deeper, you want to switch to some soft plastics, then go ahead and switch over to like a saltwater assassin or a mirror lure. And then going to the offshore, it's really starting to pick up. And I see May here coming up should be a lot better as far as weather-wise with that in April, but the Saturday's looking good. So state water snapper fishing's been really good. And there's actually a few sailfish have been showing up around the RGB Reef, which is right between Port Mansfield and South Padre Island. It's in state waters. A lot of natural wrecks have been putting up there. They've been working on it. The guy's been doing a really good job on that. And also a few Dorado being caught out there also. And the action continues to be really good. You know, and I think it's gonna be a lot better when the summer comes up. He keeps on getting better. So state water snapper fishing, the remaining gear, like I said, I drift that structure in 50, 90 feet of water. And after you're done with either you got a limit or you got enough for dinner and you're like, hey, let's pull some lines, weather's good, guys. Get some smaller islanders, rig them with some ballyhoo, pull 3 to 5 lines out at like 7.5-8 knots. And there has been some sailfish caught. Like I said, this is like literally 18 miles from the jetties, which is nothing for down here. And for the tackle there, go ahead and use a pin torque 30. This is going to work great. Get it with straight mono. So you got a stretch in there, the Mamori mono, 25 to 30 pound. And this definitely top the day off. You can relax. You hook on a billfish. There's not a better way to, you know, go back in after that. But have some gloves on, of course. Grab the bill really close, you know, so you don't hurt them or break them. And do me a favor, try to keep them in the water the best you can, and release them in good shape. So we got a picture of a sailfish here that was released off the RGV reef. So heading over to Dorado.
There's hurry, Chad.
Dorado coming up around the RGV reef also, up to the 100-fathom curve. Look for some floating debris, weed lines, rips. Always what you want to look for these guys. The smaller islanders are working really good. Feathers, cedar plugs. Also, right. If you're going to be targeting this, I'd
Chad,
still stick with that pin.
We
got to
go, Chad. I got to do the hot spots. Let's read the hot spots from the lower coast region. He says, inshore, the action's really good for trout, redfish out of South Padre Island and Araro City. The redfish are shallow, hitting mirror lure, top dog juniors, and bone color. And then offshore, good state water redfish and sailfish action with a few wahoos mixed in. Those are the shallow sport hot spots.
Dorados, the lower coast. Few Dorados in there as well.
Chad was just so passionate. Thanks for tuning in, guys, for all your wading know-how and tips. We will see you next week. Thank you very much.
Bye, guys.